are going to start with the poem Legend of Northland. You know, where is this place situated, Northland? Where it is situated? Can anybody tell which area it is? Northland, where there is, which is you can say near the, which is you can say which is the farthest part of the earth, where there is extreme cold weather that prevails, and people they use sledges in or as a means of transport to harness the running power of reindeer, and moreover, people are always wearing furry clothes, right? So this poem, it is a story about that place, Northland. It can be the Antarctica region, it can be the region on that side where there is extreme cold weather, and throughout the year this area, it is covered with only snow. It is snow covered area, right? And next is a legend. What is a legend? Legend is a story. Okay, so as it is mentioned here, you can see here in the blue box, the poem narrates the legend of an old lady who angered Saint Peter because of her greed. So this is a story about a lady who has angered Saint Peter. Why she angered Saint Peter? Because of her greed. But what she has done that made a saint to get angered, because a saint otherwise would not get angered easily. But what happened? What she has done that made the saint angry? So first of all, before we come up to the summary, let me tell you that what are the qualities of human beings. Okay, let me ask you first of all, that what are the good qualities of human beings? What do you expect of a good human being? Yes, what do you expect of a good human being? Yes, dear. Yes.
Ma'am, to be respectful of other forms of lives. To always think about others, to prosper and help others prosper as well.
Okay, to have others prosper well, right? And any other quality that comes to your mind, other students? Yes, only these qualities. Any other student? You can tell that what are the other qualities of a good human being? Yes, Panika. You can tell?
To have ability to understand others, and we should have
the ability to understand them.
We should understand them.
Of empathy, okay. To help others. To feel good for others, right? And moreover, to be respectful toward other forms of life, as Dia has said. So a human being, which is God's finest creation, God has expected that as he has made human beings, so it is their duty that they should take care of other human beings. They should respect the rights as well as the feeling of other human beings. Moreover, they should be generous, kind. Okay? What qualities we have learned in my childhood about a good human being? What qualities we have learned in the chapter My Childhood? Yes, what qualities we have learned? Yes, dear. What qualities we have learned in my childhood?
Ma'am, communal harmony, to respect your parents, to respect others' decisions, and help them achieve their goals.
And to
because
also,
everyone.
To also respect the other religion. No, to discriminate with any religion.
To be generous, to be kind. Because in that chapter, we have learned that number of people who were eating food at APJ Abdul Kalam's house was more than the actual number of family members. Right? So this we have studied there. So this is not only the feelings that we have read in that chapter. Actually, these are the feelings which form the innate personality of a human being. We always expect that a human being should be of the nature, of the type, that he should always take care of others. He should always be generous towards others. In this poem, Legend of Northlands, Saint Peter, who is a saint, who is preaching about, who is giving sermons to others, means religious teachings to others. And for that purpose, he is not, you can say he is not limited to one place. He is moving from one place to another. As he is going from one place to another, and one day what happened, he reached a place where a woman is living and she is living in a hut. She is baking cakes for her. So Saint Peter expected that as he is hungry, the woman should give him a piece of cake or some cake so that he can have his, you can say, food. But what happened? The woman first baked the cake. She did not ready to part with her cake because she thought it is too large to be given to Saint Peter. Then what she did, she took a small piece of dough and again she, you can say, she made or she baked a small cake, even smaller than the previous one. When it was baked, again she thought that no, again it is too large to be given to Saint Peter. Then again she thought that all the cakes which she was baking, they are actually large to be given to Saint Peter. She thought that they must not be given to Saint Peter. And for that, finally she came to the point when she baked only a thin wafer because she took a very small amount of dough. And Saint Peter, who was hungry, he was just again and again looking at the woman, what she was doing. But she was not at all ready to part with her cake. So this made Saint Peter angry. And what happened? In anger, what he did, he caused the woman to be changed into woodpecker. The woman, she moved or she was thrown or she was forced to move in the fire of the chimney, and ultimately she came out of the chimney in the form of a woodpecker. It means that woman, she was changed into woodpecker. So now all the clothes of the woman, they were burnt. And her, you can say, red colored cap, it remained on her head. And ultimately every school going child, he was looking at this woodpecker moving from one place to another. But why did Saint Peter change that woman into woodpecker? Because as she is not sensitive towards the feelings of hunger, towards the feeling of hunger of Saint Peter, so Saint Peter thought that she did not deserve human form. She should not live in human form as she is not ready to help others and to give food to others. And for that, he caused her that she should move, she should run from one place to another, and in order of that, she should move and find her food by boring into the tree. So this story, every person or every elder is telling his or her, you can say, grandchildren or grandchild and this story is known to everyone. So this is the, you can say, folk tale prevalent there. Okay, so what is this? This is actually a folk tale which is prevalent there, and everyone has listened. Now, the thing is that, but what the poet wants to deliver through this poem? The poet wants to deliver through this poem is that to have the feeling of charity, to be helpful towards others. As the poet wants to tell us that human being, a certain qualities are always demanded by human beings. That human beings should always be, you can say, they should always be helpful towards others. They should always be caretakers towards others. One, and they should be, you can say, philanthropic in their nature. Philanthropic means charitable in their nature, kind. They must have sense of sharing. So all these things, all these good qualities, the poet wants to deliver to this poem. So one more thing is that all the chapters which are included in this, in the CBSE or NCERT books, right? The main quality of all the chapters is there, that all the chapters, they are hand-picked, you can say. Means they are completely based upon delivering values. The first motive of all the chapters is that to deliver good qualities to the students. And you must have read, apart from getting knowledge of language, which is not the sole purpose of the book, this book also focuses upon imparting good values to human beings. Because education is not only, what education is? Can anybody tell me what education is actually? What you are daily getting education, but what is education? A very simple question, what is education? Yes, Diya.
Education is to learn basics about languages and other basic subjects, and to develop social and social skills, and to gain moral values from teachers.
Okay, right. So, education.
Overall development. In all factors.
In all aspects of life. Yes, of course, she is absolutely right. Yes, Panika also wants to speak. Yes, Panika. Yes, Panika, I have unmuted you.
Yes, ma'am, education not only means to be educated, but it means for the overall development of a human being. Like it should be perfect in every aspect of life, like in education also indulges the social skills in person.
Okay.
All right. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So education, although we use this term very often, that we are imparting education, you are getting education, but it holds so deep or such a deep meaning. If not properly understood, the purpose of the education is not fulfilled, I think so. Education is not giving textual knowledge. It is not only the learning or imparting knowledge or getting knowledge of, only facts. But actually it is getting knowledge of every aspect of the personality of human being. Every aspect, the reflective personality, which is our outside, which impresses others, the mental, you can say mental development. It means that with gaining of each and every lesson, there must be, you can say, improvement in the behavior of the student or the person. Because life goes on for the entire life, or life is a learning process itself. We cannot limit our life to learning only during childhood or during student life. No, throughout our entire life we are learning. So education means education means imparting knowledge about every aspect of life, of earning livelihood also, learning social skills, learning, you can say, vocational skills, and moreover, to understand other creatures also, other human beings also. So it is just because of this reason that what I want to deliver you is that all the chapters, they are delivering you the values. So you will see very beautiful chapters, very, you can say, heart-touching chapters are included. Okay, all are giving you knowledge of English language. But apart from it, they are also making you aware, or they are also making you learn the main, you can say, values, which are very important for a human being. So this we are going to learn in this poem also. This poem, you will see, read the poem, you will see how simple the poem is. But it is not, but you will see that what lofty aim, what heavy aim this poem, or what lofty moral this poem is carrying. It means that the greatness doesn't lie in the simplicity. Okay? Although the poem is very simple, very easy to understand, but ultimately what it delivers a great, great lesson. Okay? So before I start this poem, I would also like you to highlight that this poem is a legend. It is a common story. It is a folk story, which was being passed on from one generation to next. What are folk stories? Folk stories, folk tales. These are the tales or the stories which are being passed on from one generation to the next. From parents, from grandchildren, from grandparents to grandchildren, and then forward. And in this manner, it is moving forward. Okay? So this is a legend. Moreover, this poem, it falls in the category of a ballad. Let us see the last of this poem, where it is given in your books also. The poet Phoeb Carey, he has written it as a ballad. So what is a ballad? As I have told you the summary of the poem, I have told you that what has happened, or what is the main thing in the poem. So according to it, you have come to know that there is a story in the poem, right? There is a story in the poem, but ultimately this story is ultimately delivering us some message, some moral lesson at the end, okay? And it is passed on from one generation to the next generation, or to the oncoming generation. This is the reason it is called as ballad. So most of the times, or many times, this question can be asked that why this poem is a ballad, okay? Why this poem is a ballad? This poem is a ballad because it is a song narrating a story, okay? It is a poem, or it is a song which is narrating a story in short stanzas, and ballads are a part of folk culture or popular culture and are passed on orally from one generation to the. And how they are passed on? They are passed on from one generation to the next generation. Right? So, this is the reason why it is called as ballad. Okay? So, this is very important to understand why it is called as ballad. Okay? So, here starts the point. Away, away. See the first two lines. Repetition of which sound? First of all, AA, it is alliteration, okay, consecutive words. In the north land, where the hours of the day are few, and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through. So what this explains? This paragraph, it explains, or this stanza, it explains the actual, you can say, the actual geographical points or geographical outlook of this area, that away, away in the north. It means, first of all, this place is very, very far away from where the poet lives, where the hours of the day are few. hours of the day means days are very short. This is the quality of winter season, that the days are short and nights are long. Okay, so where the hours of the day are few and the nights are so long in winter, and the nights, they are really long in winter. Naturally, when the nights are long, people have to pass the time. They will, you can say, have their food little bit early, and later on they will sleep. This is what this poem is telling, that the nights are so long that they cannot sleep them through. When the nights are too long, you don't always feel sleepy. It is difficult for the people to pass the time. Okay, so this paragraph is completely describing the geographical condition of the area. So if we talk about the rhyme scheme of this stanza, first last word of the first line is Northland, A, few, B, winter, C, and through is D. Okay, so A, B, C, D, right? Where they harness means utilize, use. Where they harness the swift reindeer to the sledges when it snows. Sledge, what is a sledge, you know? What is a sledge? You must have seen that, yes, sledge. Yes, Diya?
Ma'am, a transportation device which is usually dragged by animals.
Yes.
In the snow-fed areas.
Yes, Panika, Lavina.
Ma'am, a wooden cart.
A wooden?
Cart.
A wooden cart. Of course, in the simple word, she's absolutely right, a wooden cart. I would have shown you the picture if I would have with me, but right now I don't have. So it is a wooden cart which is driven by reindeers mainly, okay? Okay, in the snowy areas, okay? It doesn't have any wheels, but it has flattened, you can say, some strips or you can say pieces of wood, which when dragged would move with swift movement, okay? So where they harness, it means reindeers are used to move the sledges in this area. And when it snows, because it is covered most of the time, this area, it is covered with snow. So this is the reason that why people, they use these sledges when it snows. And the children look like bear's cubs. And how the children, they look like? They look like bear's cubs. How they look like? They look like bear cubs. So here the word like is used. So which literary device it is? So which literary device this is? Yes, Ramni?
Yes, ma'am. It is simile.
It is simile. So which literary device simile. It is? It is, of course, simile. Okay? So like bear cubs, it means that the children, they are always covered, they are always covering their faces with that of, you can say, furry caps. This is the reason, and the furry clothes they were wearing as they were living in cold weather. So this is the reason they are looking like bear cubs. Cubs mean young ones of bears in their funny furry clothes. And how they were looking like in their funny furry clothes, because they were wearing funny furry. Fun, funny, you know, and furry means covered with fur. So this is what? This is also example of F and F. So what is this? This is an example of consonants, right? And moreover, see, in the first paragraph, the last line, second last line, and the nights are so long in winter that they cannot sleep them through. So here the idea, don't you feel that the idea of the first line, it is carried on to the next line, or the last line, it is continuation to that of the second last line. Am I right? Yes, it seems. So, and there is also not any punctuation mark after winter. Right? There is no punctuation mark also. So, which literary device it is? This literary device, it is called as enjambment. What it is called as? Enjambment. What is enjambment? You can write down in your book side by side. Enjambment means running over of a sentence from one verse or couplet into another. Running over of a sentence from one verse or couplet into another so that clearly related words and ideas fall in different lines. So that closely related words and ideas, they fall in different lines. So here the idea of this line, second last line, it is carried forward onto the next line. So this is the reason why it is an example of enjambment. Okay. So today what we have done the poem, we have done an introduction of this poem, Legend of Northland. So first of all, you know, for every, you can say if we have to erect any structure, first of all, we have to make the foundation. So this is what we have done today. We have laid the foundation of this poem so that you can come to know that what this poem is all about. Okay, we have done the first two stanzas, which are very simple. And tomorrow we will continue with the next, you can say, further explanation of the poem. So that's all for today. And if you have any problem, now you can raise up your hands so that I can discuss the problem.